have been that as Marilyn was inviting the children to go and hear this message on patience, that some of you were thinking you'd like to go. And somebody sitting next to you might have thought maybe you should go. What a way to start out, by insulting people, right? The people you love. Would you take out your Bibles, please? Jaime, you're leaving already? Oh, you're going to go pray. I see. It has nothing to do with patience. We have a couple men, by the way, that every Sunday morning, they leave to pray for all of us during this time of the message. If you take out your, did I ask you to take out your notes? Yellow notepad pages today? You can pull those out. So do you have convictions? I wonder what, I'm going to talk about convictions today. I wonder what convictions of yours come just right away. Yes, I have convictions, deeply held convictions, and mine are right. Absolutely, right? And 100% of the time. They're my convictions. Last night, Marilyn and I we took advantage of, watched a movie that I asked for Christmas, and one of my kids gave us A Man for All Seasons, a 1966 award-winning story of Sir Thomas More, who was Chancellor to Henry VIII. And it was a powerful movie about a man who literally went to his death because he had very, very strong convictions, and he held to them all the way to the end. I'd recommend the movie. You can buy it online, A Man for All Seasons. Oh, that we all had that kind of courage and strength of conviction. But not all of our convictions are necessarily 100% cool. I remember when shopping malls opened on Sundays. Any of you old enough to remember that with me? We had probably one of the first indoor shopping malls that was just a couple miles from our home in Minnesota. In Minnesota, you need indoor shopping malls, right? And this was Southdale in Richfield. It was just a wonderful place to go shop. But when they opened up on Sundays, I was appalled. And when my sisters began shopping at Southdale on Sunday, I was absolutely incensed. My degree of being upset with them, though, was only amplified by what happened when my sisters decided to pierce their ears. And I think I used at that point, I think I used words like hussies and called them women of the night. And I know some of you are under conviction right now, right? Thank you for those of you who are shaking your heads and saying, no, not at all. Remember when my sister-in-law, who's a missionary with Overseas Crusade, when she paid to have Marilyn's ears pierced for her 40th birthday. So there you go. There was a time when I had deeply held convictions about hairstyles. This is what you get for that, and. Convictions about hairstyles, and I remember when the Beatles came, you know, and the mop heads, the British invasion, and even then I didn't have a whole lot of hair to brag about, but so I've got my laughable convictions. How about you? What are yours? What kind of convictions would the people in your family say you have, and they'd shake their heads or laugh at your convictions? Inside of church circles, there are lots and lots of different, inside of Christianity, there's lots of different attitudes toward all sorts of things that become deeply held convictions. Today is the first Sunday of the month. What do we always do on the first Sunday of the month? We have communion. And sometimes we develop routines. It used to be, I remember when I first came to this church, that I remember an elders meeting when the point of on the agenda was that all those who, and the only people that ever served at the table were the elders, but all of the elders, we had it in the minutes of the meeting, were to wear dark suits, white shirts, and dark ties. Hello. But that was a point of conviction at that point in time. And some of you are probably shaking your heads right now to say, look what's happened to our church. Very possibly could be that way. I remember when the president of our seminary was speaking at the annual meeting for conservative Baptists in another state, and he was a very, very strongly opinionated person with convictions of, amazingly strong convictions of his own. But he stood up, Dr. Rademacher had a full beard, and he answered a question. They had a bunch of questions that people had for the president of our seminary, and he said, one of the questions was, can the president of a seminary actually boast a beard? Man, did he cut into the crowd that day. But a lot of people think facial hair. What's that person really trying to hide? Ties, facial hair, hats. I spoke once in a Romanian Baptist church here in Southern California. And as I spoke, I looked out to a congregation like this on Sunday evening. It was their Sunday evening service. They already had a long service in the morning, and this was now the Sunday evening service. And as I spoke with an interpreter, I looked out at a congregation, and on this side of the room was all women. And on this side of the room was all men. And all the men had suits on this warm summer evening and ties. And all the women wore, the women who were married wore hats as a point of demonstrating their submission to their husbands, and no jewelry whatsoever. Deeply held convictions. Music. We talked about this just a very little bit last week. I won't go into it a long time, but some folks would sometimes sit with music, and they plug their ears or fold their arms, and they say, that wasn't worshipful music. Some people, when they come to, we've a number of times gotten calls in our office. I mean, this has been for the last 35, 40 years of my ministry. Pick up the phone, somebody looking for a church, and they're doing a little bit of church shopping, and things aren't going to work when their first question is, what translation does your church use? And what translation are they looking for? Well, some of you might even have this version of the Bible, but it actually boasts in the beginning, it says the Authorized Version. So if you don't have the Authorized Version, you might not have a Bible in your hands. And deeply held convictions about translations. There are those who have strong convictions about times of the year, like the 6 weeks that precede. And you may have grown up in a church where the seasons of the year are very, very important as to what's preached when. And when it comes to the season of Lent, it's many people, you may have grown up this way and you may still operate this way during those 6 weeks prior to Easter. You consider your life and consider what it is that you should actually give up. One of our Baptist pastor friends around here that that Israel and Dennis and I meet with on a monthly basis, this last year he decided for Lent he would give up as much as entirely possible. He would give up riding in his car, and he biked absolutely everywhere. And they had places to haul their children along the way. Some people are feel very strongly about things like the news and how much exposure should I have to the news. And I know of the former president of USC who was a believer. I remember hearing him speak in a message about giving up all exposure to the news for a three-month period. He felt strongly convicted that he needed to purge his soul of exposure to the news, and so he did that. And he would just occasionally hear somebody talking about what they had read, and he said this was like going cold turkey, giving up some very, very addictive thing. Some of you may have strong opinions about things like the things you put in your mouth, like caffeine. One of my friends who has all but eliminated caffeine from his diet. Anytime I'd say, "Well, you want a cup of coffee?" he'll say, "My veins are clear." Oh, I could go on and on about these things. What kind of things are deeply held convictions for you? And what kind of convictions have you maybe abandoned along the way? Now, after that long introduction, would you turn, please, in your Bibles to Romans chapter 14. Romans chapter 14. If you're using the Bible in the rack in front of you, New International Version, it's, I think it's page 1124. Or thereabouts. I'd like you to just follow along. I'm going to read the first 12 verses. I intended to read all these verses last week, and we only covered the first four, but I'm going to begin with verse 1 and read through verse 12. This is what Paul says. In this very practical section, as he continues in this profound letter to the church at Rome. Accept him whose faith is weak. Show, that word accept, remember, means show unusual kindness. That was the word that was used to describe the kind of reception Paul and his party received when their ship was shipwrecked in a place where people were not from the same culture as Paul was from. Show unusual kindness for him whose faith is weak, without passing judgment on disputable matters. Not on matters of solid doctrinal issues, but on disputable matters. One man's faith allows him to eat everything, but another man, whose faith is weak, eats only vegetables. The man who eats everything must not look down on him who does not. And the man who does not eat everything must not condemn the man who does. For God has accepted him. God has accepted him. Meat eaters and vegetarians, even when their practice is for spiritual issues. Verse 4, who are you to judge someone else's servant? That is God's servant. To his own master he stands or falls, and he will stand, for the Lord is able to make him stand. Now unto him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to cause you to stand before his presence, blameless and with great joy.